Kentucky Derby. The history, the mystery, the magic. It's the tradition of the Twin Spires, mint juleps, it's movie stars, and international media coverage, thrilling newspaper accounts, and flowery descriptions of Derby's past by full-fledged Kentucky colonels and hard-riding hardboots. Churchill Downs, where the sun shines bright on my old Kentucky home, and on rainy Derby days too. The excited crowds, the winning colors, parimutuel tickets that can pay off big, people, parties, energy, excitement. And then, late in the afternoon, the crowd hushes in anticipation as all eyes turn toward the starting gate.
Undefeated winner of the Kentucky Derby since Seattle Snow in 1976.
A curved steep ball that is going to win the 24th running of the Kentucky Derby.
A mile and a quarter on the first Saturday in May. Contenders from across North America and from overseas, too. All running for the roses, chasing a stately golden trophy that can go to just one three-year-old horse. Just one each year.
Down the Churchill Downs stretch in the Kentucky Derby, and here comes the finish. It's going to be Swaps winning a length and a half.
And this is where chance steps in. Chance and speed and endurance. They've run this Kentucky Derby since 1875. More than 130 times without interruptions for wars or floods or lack of cash. Well into a second century, and still counting. With a story for every victory, a tale for every triumph, and a lament for every loser. Close doesn't count. It's by a mile or by a whisker. A Derby contender has one chance, just one Derby day. These are the magical memories of the world's hardest to win horse race. The stories we most remember, the landmarks along a landscape of thoroughbred history, the greatest moments of the Kentucky Derby. The year was 1948. Half a century ago, Americans had won World War II and now began a baby boom. New jobs, new hopes, new kids, and a whole new era. And along came a horse big enough for the time. His name was Citation. In the mid-20th century, Calumet Farm owned horse racing and dominated the Kentucky Derby for owner Warren Wright, who founded Calumet with a fortune made in Calumet baking powder. Wright and Calumet had the horses, the winningest string of racehorses the sport had ever known. Calumet had the trainer, or trainers actually, in Plain Ben Jones and son Jimmy Jones, Missouri farm men who made good with the world's most expensive thoroughbred racehorses. And they had the jockey, Eddie R. Carroll. As the Kentucky Derby of 1948 approached, it looked like it would be Calumet's year again, but with which horse?
Citation is the favorite, racing as an entry with Cold Town, his Calumet farm stablemate. As for the weather, well, it rains as they parade to the post, but stops in time for the big moment. And with a send-off from Ginger Rogers, they are away. 6 3-year-olds out after fame at a king-size slice of $100,000 purse. Citation and Cold Town move right into the lead with Escadrille, Grandpere, Billings, and My Request hot on their heels. There's a mile and a quarter of sloppy track to navigate, but they're moving fast towards the first turn. It looks close in the backstretch, but no, way out in front is Coal Town, pouring on the coal, so to speak, and his backers go wild. But as they go into the turn, Citation gets up steam and goes to work on his stablemate's lead. Coal Town's lead is narrowing. Citation is coming up fast. Now it's neck and neck, and as they go into the stretch, it's Citation by a head. Eddie Arcaro, after his fourth Derby win, calls for speed, and speed he gets, with its Citation increasing his lead with every thundering gallop. Coal Town and the others with Escadrille way behind. It's all Citation, just as most of the experts predicted, going on to win by 3.5 points.
Off his Derby ride, Arcaro said, "He went so fast, he scared me." Big Si went on to sweep the Triple Crown, taking down the Preakness with ease, and the Belmont Stakes after stumbling out of the gate. Citation won 19 of 20 starts as a three-year-old. Still a record, not equaled by any other horse. It would be 25 years before another champion could take all three jewels of the Triple Crown. It was Sir Barton who first achieved victory in all three Triple Crown races back in 1919. Though there wasn't even a name yet for what Sir Barton did. 11 years later, in 1930, the Fox of Bel Air, as Gallant Fox was known, with a nickname honoring the Bel Air farm of owner William Woodward, arrived at Churchill Downs on a day made for celebrities. There was Babe Ruth and Lord Derby himself, with Churchill Downs president Colonel Matt Wynn. It was Lord Derby's ancestors that had founded the English Derby, upon which the Kentucky Derby was patterned. Reporters ask Lord Derby, who has the pronunciation right? Is it Derby or Darby? Oh, either way is fine, he said. But the hat's a bowler.
And let's keep our eye on the gate. They're off. Gallant Fox in early trouble. Alcibiades rushes to the top. Alcibiades, Buckeye Poet. Tannery, one of the choices, is close up as they come by the finish wire with 1 mile to go. It's Alcibiades. Then it's Buckeye Poet Tannery. Where's Gallant Fox? Fourth or fifth on the outside. Sandy's got to get him up there. He's the even money favorite, and the crowd's excited. And there goes the great one, Gallant Fox, rushing now to take the lead as they move down the backstretch. It's Gallant Fox challenging for the lead. Alcibiades. Now Gallant Fox opens up a couple. Alcibiades, Buckeye Poet Tannery. And as they turn for home, Gallant Fox, Sandy's got him two on top. Sandy's coming to the eighth pole with Gallant Fox. And here they come in the final furlong. It's Gallant Fox out there, too. And here comes the finish now. Gallant Fox, an easy winner.
The Bel Air farm and trainer Sonny Jim Fitzsimmons were back in the winner's circle 5 years later at Churchill Downs with Omaha and on the way to another Triple Crown.
And here at the post, high-strung, nervous, excited thoroughbreds raring to go. They're off.
Omaha was a son of Gallant Fox. Some good blood flowing in that pedigree.
Westgalo behind. It's now Omaha, Roman Soldier, and Westgalo. Jockey Saunders in Omaha, number 11, coaxes the big chestnut colt, who responds with a blaze of speed and comes under the wire, paying 4-1.
Omaha's sire, Gallant Fox, had been referred to as a triple event winner, matching the record of Sir Barton. Well, triple event did not catch on as a title. But when riders began to explain the duplication by Omaha of his sire's record, the Derby, Preakness, and Belmont got the tag Triple Crown.
The finest Derby winner of the 1930s might have been that streak of dark lightning named War Admiral. 1937 was the year of the famous Ohio River flood that inundated much of Louisville and wreaked destruction on towns and cities the length of the Ohio River. The Churchill Downs track was flooded too, but finally dried out just in time for the running of the Kentucky Derby. More Derby magic. Jack Dempsey was on hand, with flood-weary Louisvillians anxious for a happy Derby day. And a visit from the Admiral.
And here they go. War Admiral, a notoriously fast breaker, gets out in front. And from the way he's traveling, jockey Kurtzinger means to keep him there.
War Admiral blazing out of the number one post position, streaking to the lead and never looking back. One of the fastest colts ever to blaze across the American turf. Yes, War Admiral had trouble later with Seabiscuit, but in the Derby and the Triple Crown series, War Admiral simply blazed away from his opponents. As his name might suggest, War Admiral was a son of Man O' War, both owned by Sam Riddle. As most folks know, Man O' War didn't win the Kentucky Derby. because he didn't run in it. Then came Whirl Away in 1941, ushering in the Calumet era. That same team who would later bring Citation to the Derby, with the trainers Plain Ben Jones and his son Jimmy, and owner Warren Wright, and the master rider Eddie Arcaro. Arcaro would eventually ride in more Kentucky Derbies than any other jockey, and with 5 victories, he won the most too. Whirl Away took no prisoners. He roared from behind and rolled on down the long downs home stretch. Mr. Longtail, as he was affectionately called, with that tail flowing behind him, waved bye-bye to his vanquished opponents in a new track record time of 2:01 2/5 seconds, a record that stood at Churchill Downs for 21 years. Just 2 years later, the 1943 run for the Roses would forever be known as the Streetcar Derby. Gas was being rationed. America was at war. But Armed Services Radio carried the news to GIs as far away as the South Pacific. And the news was good, if you liked Count Fleet. The Count took over the lead around the first turn in the Kentucky Derby and never looked back after that in any of the Triple Crown series. Always on the lead, all ones from Kentucky to Maryland to New York, winning the Derby by 3 lengths, the Preakness by 8 lengths, and the Belmont by 25. Aboard the Count for all of those wins was 4'10" jockey Johnny Longden, a Hall of Famer who also trained a Kentucky Derby winner, Majestic Prince. He's the only man ever to do that. Count Fleet was owned by Mrs. John W. Hertz. He came by his name naturally, the Count part from Father Ray Count, who had won the Kentucky Derby in 1929, and he picked up the Fleet from Mr. Hertz, founder of Yellow Cab Company of Chicago, later the namesake of Hertz Rent-A-Car. In 1946, it was a Salt. The big colt came from the famous King Ranch of Texas, 800,000 acres and bigger than the whole state of Rhode Island, with the famous Running W cattle brand also carried on the King Ranch racing silks. As a yearling, a Salt had caught his foot in a fence, leaving the foot deformed. The colt walked with a hitch, but he ran like the wind as he raced along the 1946 Triple Crown Trail. The press nicknamed the Salt the Club-Footed Comet.
Ahead 1 mile and a quarter, lies the richest purse in Derby history.
Assault was overlooked at 8-1 in the Kentucky Derby and wasn't strongly backed in the Preakness or Belmont either, but rolled to a Triple Crown triumph despite the slow learning betters.
The most decisive triumph since Whirl Away, as Assault pounds home by 8 lengths to win the Kentucky Derby.
Assault also thrived as an older horse, becoming for a time the world's leading money winner. When he died at the age of 27, he was buried at home on the King Ranch, laid to rest with his legs in running position and facing west, following the tradition of the U.S. Cavalry.
Mint juleps are not what they used to be in Kentucky, but thank God we have beautiful women and Kentucky thoroughbred still left.
Some of the most memorable moments in the greatest 2 minutes in sports have come in thrilling stretch duels ending in razor-thin triumphs. But none is more famous than the fighting finish between jockeys Don Meade and Herb Fisher in the 1933 Kentucky Derby.
Here are the thoroughbreds. The girls are watching them, and around the turn into the back stretch with good advice first, Isaiah second, and head play number 9 third. Ladies' man, the favorite, is fifth. Harry Fisher has the mount on head play, and the colt that was sold to Mrs. William Crump the day before the race for $30,000 is running nicely for his new owner. Broker's Tip, number 16, is back in the bunch. He hasn't started to come on and looks just like any other Broker's Tip at this stage. Then, into the home stretch. Head play is on top, but Broker's Tip with Don Meade up has made his move and is third on the rail. Charlie O is second. A jamming, slamming drive for the finish. Broker's Tip, who has held it almost 9-1, is coming through on the inside. Jockeys Meade and Fisher are giving and taking plenty of punishment, but the judges don't notice as the boys grab and slash at each other. It's the closest finish in years and the roughest. Broker's Tip wins.
As the thundering duo neared the finish, Louisville Courier-Journal photographer Wallace Lowry rolled from under the fence and snapped a photograph that would become Derby history and one of the greatest sports photos ever taken. Immediately after the race, the Churchill Downs stewards posted the inquiry sign. The judges ruled both riders equally at fault. Later, they would hand suspensions to both. But with no other horses involved, the judges let the order of finish stand. Broker's Tip was the winner, Minutes later, after the trophy presentation, Fisher and Meade resume their battle in a jocks' room brawl. Interestingly, the Kentucky Derby would be the first and last race ever won by Broker's Tip, because it was the only race he ever won. 24 years later, 1957, and it's another furious finish. But this time, there's no fighting. Many say it was the greatest field ever assembled under the Twin Spires, and it produced another memorable duel to the wire.
Here is Churchill Downs, where they've been running the Kentucky Derby since 1875. And here come the fans and the fanciers of Hoss Flesh, 90,000 of them on a cold, windy day. Cold enough for a hot toddy, but tradition dictates a mint julep. Here, too, is the veteran trainer, Sonny Jim Fitzsimmons, and Bold Ruler, 6-5 favorite. But now bring on the thoroughbreds. General Duke has been scratched, but stablemate Iron Liege is running. Number 5 is Gallant Man, Willie Shoemaker up. Eddie Arcaro is on Bold Ruler, the favorite. But it's no day for favorites, and there's real drama in the making. All eyes on the starting gate.
And they're away, a field of 9 of the nation's top thoroughbreds and a long mile and a quarter chest with a $107,000 jackpot awaiting the winner. As they charge by the stand for the first turn, Federal Hill has the lead. Bold Ruler second with Iron Liege right after it. Down the back stretch, Federal Hill still sets the pace, but now Iron Liege moves up to challenge as Bold Ruler drops back to third. Rounding the far turn into the home stretch, jockey Willie Hartack has taken the lead with Iron Liege. Federal Hill and Bold Ruler fading as Gallant Man with jockey Shoemaker makes his bid coming fast. It's a race to the wire with jockey Shoemaker on Gallant Man number 5 overtaking Iron Liege. Then Shoemaker mistakes the 16th pole for the finish and stands in his stirrups. The error makes his mount break stride. Iron Liege goes on to win by a nose. Did you see it? Here, take a good look. There's Shoemaker standing up in the mistaken belief he's past the finish line. This will be one of Turfdom's famous errors. For Shoemaker and Gallant Man, a heartbreaker. But for the Calumet colors, another great victory. Iron Liege, the little-known stablemate of the famous General Duke, is Kentucky Derby champ for 1957.
Just 2 years later, Shoemaker atoned for his error, claiming a win when it looked like he couldn't in another fight to the finish. This time, the shoe was on the other foot aboard Tommy Lee, an English bred.
Making the bend into the stretch is Tommy Lee on the rail and score dance on the outside. Both refuse to give an inch. And they enter the stretch shoulder to shoulder for the lead. Now Sword Dancer gets his nose in front, but Tommy Lee sticks right with him. And the two are battling for every inch of the long stretch. With an eighth of a mile to go, both jockeys are riding furiously. And a close-quarters duel marks those cards to the wire. First landing is now third. With a short distance remaining, Sword Dancer's in front, but Tommy Lee comes on again. And as they hit the wire, Tommy Lee wins by a nose.
Afterwards, Shoemaker would say that every time he got Tommy Lee in front, Sword Dancer would answer by powering back into the lead. So Shoemaker waited until just before the wire, he asked Tommy Lee for his best. The shoe had timed this one just right. And who could ever forget Ali Sheba overcoming near disaster to take the 1987 Kentucky Derby? Seemingly always a trouble horse, Ali Sheba came into the Kentucky Derby off a victory in the Bluegrass Stakes at Keeneland, or almost a victory. The Big Bay was disqualified for bullying his rivals around in the stretch. But no one told Ali Sheba his triumph didn't count. And Ali Sheba moved on to the Kentucky Derby full of confidence.
And they're off. Demons be gone. Away quickly from between horses. Now there goes Leo Castelli on the inside, though Capote grabs.
Down the stretch, front running Bet Twice suddenly veered into Ali Sheba's path. And Ali Sheba stumbles and almost goes down, almost pitching jockey Chris McCarron out of the saddle.
On the outside, here comes Ali Sheba, on the line, dropping out of it. Middle of the racetrack.
But Ali Sheba is not to be denied his Kentucky Derby.
And down the stretch they come. Bet Twice on the inside, leads it by a head. On the outside, here comes Ali Sheba. Ali Sheba with Chris McCarron to the front. Bet Twice back to second. Here's the finish. Wins it by 3 parts of a length.
I felt I had his measure right here, but when Craig asked his colt to run, Bet Twice responded very well. But as you can see right here, he ducked out in front of me and I clipped his heels.
Boy.
Watch my colt. Look at that. That is unbelievable how
he
almost recovered.
Went down.
I thought I was gone. And how he recovered from that and beat that colt is beyond me.
Maybe a good rider helped.
Well, I don't know. Again, he ducked out in front of me right there, and I was very concerned. And at this point, I felt that if Betwice had beaten me, then he probably would come down. But right here, I certainly want to beat him fair and square anyway.
A few of the more caustic critics were saying, this horse is crazy. He's not going to win a big race.
Oh, he's not the least bit crazy. All he is a kid. He's only a three-year-old, and he's probably a younger three-year-old in his head than the other colts in the race were. But as you can see, he's got a lot of talent.
McCarron also claimed Derby Roses in 1994 aboard Go for Gin. This time, no horses crossed his path, as McCarron and Go for Gin went wire to wire for the victory. Derby days are great days for the strapping colts who earn the roses. But the winner's circle at Churchill Downs is not limited to great men of the turf. Some days, it's Ladies' Day. In 132 years of history, just three fillies have won the Kentucky Derby. The first was Regret, who went wire to wire for owner Harry Payne Whitney way back in 1915. That was 40 years after the race had begun in 1875. Then, after Regret, it was 65 more years until a filly found the winner's circle again in the Kentucky Derby. That was 1980, and the fine filly was Genuine Risk, rolling past the field under jockey Jacinto Vasquez.
Challenge, Rock Hill native on the outside. Plutnikl is right there, and there goes Genuine Risk. Now they're tightly bunched as they move to the top of the stretch, and Genuine Risk on the outside takes the lead. It's Genuine Risk in front, 3 parts of the length. Rock Hill native on the inside, a second, and Plutnikl third. Here comes Jacqueline Tutman in the middle of the track, and down the stretch they come. It's Genuine Risk in front, 3 parts of the length. Here comes Jacqueline Tutman up to be second. Rumbo in the middle of the racetrack is flying. Rock Hill native drops back. They're in the final furlong. It's Genuine Risk, and she's genuine. Here comes Rumbo on the outside. Genuine Risk is going to win it. Genuine Risk by one. Rumbo on the outside.
Yes, a filly could do it. And the boys took notice. Then, in 1988, it was Winning Colors, fresh in from California, under the direction of charismatic trainer Dwayne Lucas. At the start, Winning Colors burst from post position 11, looking to lead all the way. The big gray filly, carrying owner Eugene Klein's blue and gold silk, said, "Watch me go."
To the top of the stretch, she's led from the start, every pole a winning one, and it's Winning Colors showing the way as they straighten away in the lane. Winning Colors doing it just like Dwayne Lucas said she would, taking command and drawing off. Now she's in front by three, Proper Reality a second. Here comes 49er, two-year-old champ from last year, putting in a bid on the outside, and down the stretch they come. Winning Colors in front. Here comes 49er on the outside. Lucas and Stevens, it's a driving finish. Winning Colors by a head, wire to wire with Gary Stevens in the iron. It was 49er on the outside, coming from far back at the head.
Can you put it into words?
It's like a dream. She's incredible. She did it, I didn't. I was a passenger. She's incredible.
Thank you very much, and I'd really like to salute all the women of America. This one's for you, gals. All right.
This one's for just all the guys that ever dreamed it. It's from here to the top of the world, and we're looking down.
Surprises? Yes, in a way. But all three fillies who won the Kentucky Derby were well back to the windows and proved their worth to doubters. But for real surprises, Derby history has big payoff long shots. In 1995, once again, the Lucas Stevens team topped the tote board with $51 winner Thunder Gulch.
And they're off in a Kentucky Derby.
Thunder Gulch started from way outside in post position 16.
Thunder Gulch with the white blinkers and Gary Stevens aboard has something to say about this Derby as they turn for home a little more than a quarter of a mile to go. Serena Song desperate to hang. Talking man on the inside, but Thunder Gulch emerges with the lead, and Thunder Gulch with Gary Stevens takes command. Talking man along the inside, and now here comes Tejano Run, and in the middle of the racetrack, it's Eltish along with Jumrun, and down the stretch they come in the Derby, and here's the winner. It's Thunder Gulch. Lucas wins it with the lesser of the three horses he trained. How about that? Thunder Gulch wins it.
Thunder Gulch was the second of four Lucas-trained Kentucky Derby winners. That included the 1996 and 99 winners, Grindstone and Charismatic. Both were long shots for Lucas, a trainer who has stamped himself on the face of American horse racing as he's carved his name in Kentucky Derby history. The so-called experts didn't give Donerail much of a chance in the 1913 Kentucky Derby. No chance was more like it. Even owner, trainer, breeder T.P. Hayes advised jockey Roscoe Goose to just race for Cornbread, meaning that Goose should lay back in the field and try to save enough to run past tired horses, maybe get third or fourth if they were lucky. But jockey Goose had other ideas when he suddenly found himself close to the lead at the top of the stretch and Donerail ready to run to glory. Donerail did it at 91-1, paying a whopping Derby record $184.90 to win. Sometimes the magic is in the names. Donerail was named for the tiny bluegrass village where the first Derby winner, Aristides, was born. Ponder was a son of Pensive, and decidedly a son of Determined, all Derby winners. In 1953, that magic came in the form of one of the biggest upsets in Derby history. Unbeaten champion Native Dancer was defeated, the only race the Dancer ever lost, by a horse named Dark Star.
And they're off. 11 3-year-olds out after fame and the winning share of the $118,000 purse. Number 10, Dark Star, comes fast on the outside to take the lead. Dark Star, winner of the Derby trial, is fifth choice of the bettors at 25-1, but his star is rising today. The Kane Hoy stable entry holds his lead in the back stretch with the favorite Native Dancer back in the pack. Eddie Arcaro on Correspondent, seeking his sixth Derby win, makes his bid on the final turn, but Correspondent can't keep up the pace. Eric Gurren up on Native Dancer makes his move at the top of the stretch, overtaking Correspondent, number 3, and setting his sights on the front-running Dark Star. Is this the end of the victory trail for Native Dancer, or can he make up for lost time? Here's the finish in slow motion and a thriller. The Dancer, under solid whipping for the first time in his career, closes the gap with every stride. And jockey Henry Moreno on Dark Star knows he's got a race on his hands. It's going to be close. It's a heartbreaker for Native Dancer. He gave it a try, but loses by a head to Dark Star, leader all the way, paying his backers handsomely for their support.
A sad day for Native Dancer fans, but the thrill of a lifetime for horse breeder Warner Jones, the future chairman of the board of Churchill Downs. The Run for the Roses is the dream, too, for anyone who welcomes a newborn foal into the world, usually late at night when the mare delivers, perhaps under a shining Dark Star. 1992 was supposed to be the year of Arazi. The European invader was hailed as a conquering hero, and he was bet down to less than even money in the Kentucky Derby. But Derby Day wasn't to be Arazi's day.
And they're off in the Kentucky Derby. Lily T. Brooke Sharkley.
Instead, the day belonged to jockey Pat Day and an unsung local lad named Lily T.
And Lily T. just he ran a monster race. He broke well, was well positioned going into the first turn. Got into some traffic, had to steady, got back on his feet thereafter, was moving nicely down the backside.
Dance Floor has the lead. Pine Bluff is second, Casualize is third, and Arazi on the outside is gaining ground with every stride.
Arazi went by me with Pat Valenzuela and nothing but horse underneath of it. I thought that I would be running for second money at the very best. Much to my delight, when I pulled out and followed him around the turn, he didn't continue to widen on me.
Next, middle of the racetrack, Lily T. Here comes Casualize, putting in a run between horses. And down the stretch they come. Lily T on the outside with Pat Day takes command. Casualize is second and the others are dropping back. Coming through the stretch and to the wire. Lily T on the outside has the lead by one. Casualize is second. Lily T wins the Derby by one.
At that point, there was just this awesome feeling that started to well up from way down deep inside that is just absolutely, positively indescribable. The feeling of winning the greatest race in the history of racing, it just was absolutely mind-boggling.
If you're talking about Derby long shots, how about Giacomo?
Alex is in behind them. Closing Argument is in with the chance there on the outside. Buzzard's Bay coming down the middle of the track at the top of the stretch in the Kentucky Derby. High Five, Bellamy Roll. Closing Argument on the far outside. Here comes a short lead. Giacomo, a fleet act. It's a three-horse photo finish. And on the wire, it's Giacomo, who has won the 131st Kentucky Derby. Close for second.
A big day for the West in 2005. Tall California trainer John Sheriffs, rider Mike Smith from New Mexico, and California owner Jerry Moss and his wife, Ann. Moss, the founder of A&M Records, named his Derby winner Giacomo after the son of music star Sting. It was a California kind of Derby. Giacomo's shocker led to some Wild West payoffs. Giacomo returned $102.60 to win. The exacta was over $9,800. The trifecta paid over $133,000. And the superfecta came in at a cool $1.7 million. On the other side of the odds coin, some horses are fan favorites because of their sterling past performances and the aura of invincibility. And with Seattle Slough, it might be said it was the look in his eye. Slough's style was simple: go to the front and never look back. Seattle Slough came to the 1977 Kentucky Derby unbeaten and appeared to stand above his competition.
Finally, I spent last evening with your jockey, Jean Cruguet. I found him, in perfect honesty, terribly distressed by things he had been reading, and even by some of Eddie Arcaro's statements about the way he rode Slough in the Flamingo.
John's cold competitor, and it's very important in the Derby. The thing about the Derby is the person that finishes first wins the race, and Hardtack was cold, Arcaro was cold. I think that's very important, and John's the kind of rider you want to have in the Derby.
But the brilliant colt missed the Derby start by just a beat. When Slough got off slow, jockey Jean Cruguet found himself behind a wall of horses.
Seattle Slough broke slowly, breaking on the lead.
If it's anything, he wanted to get out. He never wanted to stay on the gate. He just go through the gate. And when he plugged the start there, he was like that, and he wanted to go. And then I went behind a bunch of horses, and I bumped two, three horses. I sent him. I sent him. If I see still, he would listen to me. I sent him. He didn't move his way. I moved my way. He didn't. I make him do. That was the Kentucky Derby. You know, you only got one chance, and that was it. You know.
It's Seattle Slough, however, that takes it over at the head of the stretch. Seattle Slough moving away. Now opens 2.5. Run, Dusty Run, driving up on the outside into second. Steve's friend, here's Sanhedrin now closing also along the inside. Coming to the wire, Seattle Slough opens it to four lengths. At the finish, it's going to be Seattle Slough, and he's going along easily.
With trainer Billy Turner and the Slough crew carefully managing their star speed, Slough's Derby triumph was followed by victories in the Preakness and the Belmont. Seattle Slough had cost owners Karen and Mickey Taylor just $17,500. But after reigning as the 10th Triple Crown winner in history, he was now the world's most valuable racehorse. Slough remains the first and only horse to be undefeated through a Triple Crown campaign. In 3 years of racing, Seattle Slough won 14 of 17 starts, then went on to become one of the great stallions of the 20th century. He sired 1983 Kentucky Derby winner Swale and stamped his offspring with his best traits: the fleetest of the fleet, the speed of the speed. Few horses can rival the popularity of 2004 Derby winner Smarty Jones. From humble beginnings, Smarty Jones was a little guy's kind of horse. He had a people's kind of name. Who couldn't love it? And the folks around Smarty Jones captured the affection of the country. Roy and Pat Chapman were from the East, but it wasn't uptown New York. It was blue-collar Philadelphia. An hour before post time, rain poured down on the Twin Spires, and plenty of rivals showed up with ideas of their own about winning.
In the Kentucky Derby, Imperialism got a little bump from the Cliff's Edge at the start. Read the footnotes, comes away in good order, and there's Lionheart flashing his early speed today. Minister Eric is up close to the pace. Limehouse down toward the inside has been taken back. Quinton's Gold Rush on the far outside. Bias for the first time. Lionheart leads the way in a host of pursuers. Minister Eric is there. Read the footnotes is third. Smarty Jones very eager. He's fourth.
But Smarty was here to party, and he ran like he owned the Kentucky Derby.
Smarty Jones is a stalking second as they approach the far turn. Pollard's Vision in the clear, and he's right there third. Minister Eric down on the inside, moving from fourth. Read the Footnose is handling the track well. He's fifth between horses with a half mile to run. They've run three quarters in 1:11.4. Borrego's beginning to pick it up on the outside. Pollard's Vision threads his way through in between horses, and there goes Tappet. Tappet is circling horses on the far outside, and the Cliff's Edge is following him, and Imperialism is pisking his way through down toward the inside, now to the outside, and Master David follows him. They're 12 lengths from the lead as Lionheart turns for home, and undefeated Smarty Jones comes wide off the turn, and these two hook up at the top of the stretch. Lionheart is all heart. Smarty Jones is all out, and those two deadlocked at the eighth pole, and Smarty Jones is roused to the lead by journeyman jockey Stuart Elliott, and they have taken the lead away from Lionheart. Farther back, it's Limehouse and Imperialism, and here is the first undefeated winner of the Kentucky Derby since Seattle Slew in 1977.
Smarty was the Chapman's first Kentucky Derby starter, along with trainer John Service and jockey Stuart Elliott. Tough to do, win the Kentucky Derby with all first-time starters. Rivalries. It's the mystery and passion that make racing legend and lore. And the Kentucky Derby, which brings the best from every region of the land, perfectly sets up the showdowns that put the drama into rivalries, like East versus West. They don't come any more blue-blooded than Nashua, another stellar steed from Bel Air Stud. Swaps people were California cowboys, real cowboys with dust on their boots, named Rex Ellsworth and Mesh Tenney. All across the country, fans were saying their names. Nashua sounded regal. Swaps sounded fast. But the best part of this rivalry, outside of the horses, was the riders. It was the two legendary Derby jockeys, Bill Shoemaker on California's Swaps and Eddie Arcaro on New York's Nashua. Over his career, Arcaro would win five Kentucky Derbies. Shoe would win four. And the presence of the pair at Churchill Downs on the first Saturday in May was as expected as mint juleps and the singing of My Old Kentucky Home.
And they're off. And that's Nashua broke on top with Honey's Alibi, Trim Destiny. And Swaps rushes on the outside. Now Swaps gets the lead. Trim Destiny on the rail. That is Nashua and Summit 10 on the outside. Now they've moved into the back stretch, and Swaps leads by about a half a length. Trim Destiny's on the inside second. Then it is Nashua and Summer 10, but they're turning for home. And who's the leader? Swaps is out there. Willie's got him going good. He's about three-quarters of a length in front of Nashua. Swaps, Nashua on the outside trying hard. But Shoemaker's got Swaps in hand. Now leads by two lengths with a 16th to go. Swaps and Nashua battling down the Churchill Down stretch in the Kentucky Derby. And here comes the finish. It's going to be Swaps winning a length and a half. Nashua second.
Was Swaps the best? Hard to say. Nashua later bested Swaps in a match race in Chicago. But Swaps set track records throughout his career, and he won the Kentucky Derby. Again in 1989, racing fans were divided much along geographic lines, with Eastern fans staunchly backing Easy Goer, and the Westerners lined up with Sunday Silence. Interestingly, the people behind the horses made the story even better. Easy Goer represented the Phipps family, the greatest force in New York racing, with Kentucky-based Pat Day in the saddle. The Sunday Silence camp got its flavor from the Bald Eagle, California trainer Charlie Whittingham. Whittingham named Pat Valenzuela to ride, and the stage was set.
They're all in line, and they're off. And Sunday Silence at the start comes right in and bumps Triple Buck. Houston takes the early lead on the outside. Dansel. Clever Trevor along the inside is third. And here comes Northern Wolf, and again a few bumps. And Easy Goer is fifth at this point on the outside in great position, passing the stance for the first time.
This Sunday Silence Easy Goer rivalry would continue in battles farther down the road. But the Derby belonged to Sunday Silence.
Continental, it's still Houston in front by three parts of a length. Northern Wolf second. Here comes Sunday Silence on the outside. The entry of Easy Goer and awe-inspiring next as they straighten away in the stretch. Sunday Silence with Pat Valenzuela comes over, has a little contact with Northern Wolf. On the inside, Houston is dropping out of it. Dansel is still tough. On the inside, then comes Easy Goer and awe-inspiring. inspiring, but with a 16th of a mile to go. And here comes Sunday Silence through the stretch, coming to the finish of the Derby. Sunday Silence wins this Derby by 2 lengths. It's a photograph between Easy Goer and on the outside, awe-inspiring.
For many fans, the most anticipated rivalry in the Kentucky Derby was the 1978 run for the Roses. Not because the finish was close, it wasn't, but because of the familiarity between its two great stars, Affirmed and Alidar. That rivalry began the prior year when the pair squared off several times in the top stakes races in the East for juvenile runners. Over the winter before the Kentucky Derby, Alidar went south to Florida to train, and Affirmed went west. After that, all they did was win, setting up one of the greatest storylines in Kentucky Derby history. Alidar was the pride of Calumet Farm, trained by John Veach and ridden by riding champion George Velasquez. Affirmed was owned by Lewis and Patrice Wolfson, longtime racing notables, and trained by legendary Laz Barrera. The rider was the kid, 18-year-old riding sensation Steve Coffin.
They're already in. Side. There goes Raymond Earl, and Affirmed is right there and challenging between horses. Out in the middle of the track, that's Aesop's Foibles into the third spot. Sensitive Prince in the middle of the racetrack moves up as they passes for the first time. It's Raymond Earl now showing the way by a length and three quarters. Alidar on the extreme outside is next, then Special Honor racing 10th, and Dr. Valeria is 11th as they move on to the backstretch. And on the outside, there goes Sensitive Prince taking command as Raymond Earl drops back second by four, and Affirmed is third at this point. The first quarter in 22 and 3/5 seconds, and the half in 45 and three. And down the backstretch, Sensitive Prince now enjoys a 2.5 length advantage. Raymond Earl is second by three. Affirmed is third by a length and a quarter. Along the inside, Aesop's Foibles is racing fourth.
Affirmed ranged out early to run near the pace, while Alidar settled near the back. That tactic didn't play out well for Alidar, who could never reach Affirmed to take up the battle.
Gains ground in eighth position as they round the far turn. 3/8 of a mile to go in this Kentucky Derby. It's Sensitive Prince, and up on the outside, there goes Affirmed with a rush. Affirmed takes command by a head. Sensitive Prince is second, and Believe It moves quickly to the leaders as the field turns for home. Coming to the quarter pole, Affirmed on the inside, Believe It on the outside, Believe It on the outside, Affirmed toward the rail, and down the stretch they come. Affirmed on the inside, takes command again. Believe It is second, Alidar gains ground third. They're in the final furlong. It's Affirmed with Stevie Cawthon showing the way by 2.5. Believe It with Edna Phillies next, and on the outside, Alidar is third, but it's going to be Affirmed. Affirmed with Steve Cawthon is going to win this 104th running of the Kentucky Derby. Alidar is second, Believe It third. Gap of four lengths, followed by Darby Creek Road, Aesop's Fable, and the rest. Well, it was Affirmed stalking the early pace and quickly moving to command and never...
The ease of Affirmed's victory did not sway bettors, who made Alidar the favorite again in the Preakness and in the Belmont Stakes. Both races were won by Affirmed to become America's last Triple Crown winner. Affirmed always seemed to have an answer when Alidar would ask the question. Racing writer Dan Farley summed up the Affirmed-Alidar rivalry that so charmed the Kentucky Derby and Triple Crown of 1978. What was it that made the difference between the two colts, asked Farley. After more than 9 miles of competition over 3 years, the superiority of one over the other could be voiced in a whisper. Still, the difference was there, and it had come from within. Do horses know that they're going to win the Kentucky Derby? Do they have that special kind of stage presence when the rest of us are just hoping? Secretariat came to the 99th Kentucky Derby in 1973 as the most popular racehorse in America. In his first season on the track, Secretariat had become the first 2-year-old ever to be named Horse of the Year. But his sports stardom carried far beyond racing, with millions of new fans from every corner of the globe tuned in and turned on by the magic about him. But many fans jumped off the bandwagon when the Big Red Horse struggled home third in his final Kentucky Derby prep in New York.
And I told them not to worry, that he was not going to disgrace himself on Saturday.
But those who were closest to Secretariat in the Meadow stable were actually gaining confidence. Groom Eddie Sweat and exercise rider Charlie Davis, who turned in the morning miles in the saddle, saw the change in Secretariat as the Meadow Stable crew arrived in Louisville to contest the Kentucky Derby.
He gave me a vibe, a stronger vibe, like, hey man, I'm the man. See, you just go for the ride. I wasn't the pilot, I was the co-pilot.
As handicappers fretted over their figures and wrestled with their systems, Davis and Sweat simply stayed close to their stalwart.
I sleep with him. I mostly eat with him. Because sometimes I get my sandwich from the kitchen, I sit in the front of the stall.
Meanwhile, Secretariat's trainer, Lucian Lauren, was peppered with questions about it all. Could Secretariat do it? Was Secretariat sound? What did Secretariat eat for breakfast? That's where owner Penny Chenery stepped up to answer reporters' questions.
For the Derby, there are a lot of sports reporters who don't know horses, but they're assigned by their local paper. I had a baseball writer. He said, how old is your horse? I'm thinking they're all three-year-olds, buddy. But but he said, answer every question as if you've never heard it before. This is Lucian. And speak to everybody the same way. Give the same amount of attention to the next guy. And it was wonderful advice. Then I had a job. My job was to represent the horse who couldn't speak.
Of course, all of this talk was just part of the anticipation. What everybody does until the race actually begins. That 1 2-minute race. That for every horse comes just one time. On one day. Jockey Ron Turcotte, aboard Secretariat, recalls the feeling.
They always said, well, you're going to ride in the Kentucky Derby. You're going to get a feeling that you've never had before. When you start playing my old Kentucky home, your horse start prancing under you, you know, seem like you're going to the music, and then, you know, your hair go up your spine.
And of course, it wasn't all about Secretariat. He had 12 rivals to beat in the 99th run for the Roses, and then into the starting gate. That moment of suspense.
Secretariat throws his head a bit.
Secretariat. In the number 10 post. He breaks very poorly. In fact, last. But Turcotte was never concerned.
Secretariat was the greatest horse, was head and shoulder above any horse I rode against, or seen.
Challenge, and those two are heads apart. Royal and Regal is third and holding on. Goldback drops back. Secretariat is fourth and moving up on the outside and is now.
But Turcotte, who had won the Derby with Reaver Ridge the previous year, knew what it took to win the race, and the horse he had under.
He leads it by a length. Secretariat is in the center of the racetrack and driving. Checky Green now drops back. Coming on a bit is Forgo, our native on the outside. Now and then the stretch, it's Secretariat. Secretariat on the outside to take the lead. Sham holding in second. It's Secretariat moving away. He has it by 2.5. Sham, then on the outside, our native. At the wire, it's going to be Secretariat. He wins it by 2 lengths.
All of the pre-race questions about Secretariat had been answered by the super horse himself. He had run every quarter mile of the Derby distance faster than the one before, and was actually running his fastest at the end of the mile and a quarter down the long Churchill Downs home stretch, doing it the way he did it, with a powerful closing rush, burying the doubters, and running the news up to the top of the Twin Spires. Secretariat, making his own memorable moment in the run for the Roses. These are the moments of greatness. When the champions make their mark. On that one special day. On the first Saturday in May. Amid the history and the mystery, the triumphs. And the traditions of the Kentucky Derby.